Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelites are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase and in an event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities from Pithom and Ramesses for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites, until the Egyptians became ruthless impostors, imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, it had been 400 years since Joseph, remember Joseph, the dreamer whose brothers got tired of his incredible stories. They thought he was lying and making up stuff. And remember, they sold him off to a band of travelers, and he ended up in Egypt, but found favor with the king. And he lived in the king's house. There are some interesting stories. That's all before this chapter I just read. But since 400 years since that they forgot about Joseph, says the king didn't remember Joseph, the Israelites have prospered. And so much so that the new king became paranoid. It was not unusual for kings to be paranoid. King Herod was the most paranoid of all kings. It must have run in the line of being a king, worried about your security, your borders, all your possessions. And so they decided to plot that since the Israelite women were having children, that they would find out when they were born, go to their place of living, and take the babies and throw them in the Nile River. There was one problem. The Israelite women were so strong and healthy, they'd have them babies before the midwives could get there to take them away. And the numbers kept growing and growing and growing. And one of those babies born during that time was a little baby named Moses. Y'all remember Moses' story? His mama was fearful, and the Lord told her to put him in a little basket. They made the basket. I remember coloring those baskets in Sunday school when I was little. I don't know if any of y'all did that. And the story was that they knew where the king's daughter would bathe in the river with her associates. And sure enough, there was that basket. And they found that beautiful baby. She took him home. And remember that Moses' sister went and got her mama to help raise Moses in the king's palace. All the while, his kinsmen were toiling at the hands of ruthless taskmasters. You remember that part in the story, but when Moses became a young man, a young adult perhaps, he saw one of the Egyptians beating one of the slaves mercilessly, and in a fit of rage like that, Moses pounced on the guy, and he killed him. And it led Moses to flee for his life, and he went up into the mountains to become a sheep herder for a while until God called him back. Remember that story. I told you we were covering a lot of ground this morning. That burning bush. And God called Moses and his brother Aaron to go back to Egypt and to face the fierce Pharaoh and to proclaim to him to let God's people go. And so the Pharaoh said, "Oh, okay, y'all go right ahead." No, he didn't. It got worse. In fact, the slaves, the Hebrew slaves, were making bricks to build all these edifices. And the Pharaoh got so mad, he said to the overseers and the taskmasters, he says, "Take away their straw." They use straw as an acid to help form the bricks to become solid. "Let them gather their own and increase their quotas that they're to make each day." That's like pouring a match on gasoline. And it just, the intensity and the back-breaking pressure and the meanness and the indignancy of the king increased exponentially. And people were crying out to God. And Moses was crying out to God, why have you forsaken us? Aren't we your chosen people, the one who you made covenant with our father Abraham? Where are you? You sent me back to do a mission. Where are you? What the Israelite people learned, that in Scripture, oftentimes, things get worse before they get better. The work of God is through systems, oftentimes, that are vile and even tyrannical. It's often to see the greater good down the road because it's too far. That's what Moses and Aaron faced when they went back to confront Pharaoh. The Israelites could not see that God was at work in God's time, and that their suffering would not be in vain. That injustice is real, but God is still a God of goodness in the face of injustice, and God is always at work because His will is ever directed to His children's good. Where have you felt and experienced injustice in your life? Maybe it was in elementary school when you were always the last one picked for the team. That doesn't feel very good, does it? I grew up, maybe you have too, hearing the expression, the one with the gold makes the rules. That's unfair. It seems unfair to me. Why is that true, though? I like country music. And one of my favorite country singers is not as popular as he once was, but I've got his CD that plays in my car. His name's Travis Tritt. And he's got a song that has some lines in it that are about injustice. Here's just a few of those. Now, won't you tell me, if you can, why life's, because life's so hard to understand. Why, listen, look at this one. Why the rich man's busy dancing while the poor man's paying the band. Oh, they're billing me for killing me. Lord, have mercy on the working man. It's true. It is true. There's another phrase I bet you know and have said yourself. I know I have, and I have felt it. It is not what you know that counts. It is who you know. Ain't it so? Ain't it so? I'll never forget my oldest son, Graham, was a pretty fair soccer player. He didn't go to high school here. You'd have to take my word for it. But I remember when he was in middle school in Northwest Rankin School down in Rankin County, he was good. He didn't play. His daddy and mama couldn't travel every weekend to play soccer like some of y'all did for a season. I know we have some soccer players here in this room, some good ones. But it came time to try out for the high school soccer team at Northwest Rankin. Graham didn't make the team because he didn't play a certain league called Chicago Fire. Every boy on the high school team that was selected had played Chicago Fire. Now, his mama told that story last night at our neighbor's house. I thought, I bet that didn't feel too good. The man with the gold, it's who you know. It's who you know. I'll never forget a story that my professor of preaching, Dr. Fred Craddock, told. He was a young, diminutive-sized man. Growing up, he had a summer job working on a truck farm, harvesting vegetables and loading them onto trucks. And he and this young boy, big old strapping country boy, worked side by side. They looked like Mutt and Jeff. And they worked all week, and it came time for payday on Friday. And they got their paychecks, and Fred noticed, he just happened to glance over and noticed that this boy's check was 25% less than his. And Fred's not a big fella now, you got to understand. He's like 18, 19 years old. And he stood outside the office of that farm, and he finally mustered up his courage, and he took both checks to the office with him, and he put them down in front of the man that owned the farm, and he said, "We worked the same job, we worked the same hours, we did the same task. Why is his 25% less than mine?" Dr. Craddock said the man took the check, looked at him, and excuse me. That was not planned. He tore it up, and he wrote him a check for the equal amount, the same amount that Fred had made. And he looked up at him, he stuck it out there, he said, "I didn't know he could read. You know he's dumb as a stick." Sometimes life is unfair. But God has always been on the side of the oppressed and those who are mistreated. Scripture bears it out over and over. I wondered this week as our nation celebrated another year of independence, would we stop and confess the injustices of our current culture? And some of the dark sins of our past. As benevolent as we are, and we are a benevolent people, we are guilty of mistreating others, intentionally or unintentionally. And there's enough blame to go around. And yet, God is at work through systems. Sometimes it's through protest. Sometimes it's through sanctions. Sometimes it's just through one voice that speaks the truth. "I have a dream," he said. Sometimes it's when a victim musters the courage to speak, "No, never again." And they live through and fight for their independence and their freedom from tyranny. My friends, life is unfair and injustice comes. But do not despair. Do not give up. It may get worse before it gets better. But we are never left hopeless. All you have to do is gaze on the table this morning to see the symbols and reminders that God's promise is faithful and true. And in the beauty and the text of the song that was just sung prior to the message, sometimes his blessings are in disguise. Do not give up hope. God's will is always directed to God's children's good. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.